The $550 billion bipartisan infrastructure bill passed by the Senate in August contains $6 billion in funding for nuclear reactors, including money for an ambitious test reactor project. Forbes contributor James Conco wrote that the funding, while a step in the right direction, is not enough to sufficiently strengthen the national nuclear program in time to mitigate climate change, and advocates for even greater investments. Not everyone agrees, though. Greg Yatsko, former chairman of the U.S. Nuclear Regulatory Commission and founder of Maxine Energy, a clean energy solutions firm, wrote in the Hill opinion section this week that current U.S. nuclear projects, including those funded in the infrastructure bill, fail to meet standards on, quote, deployment cost and speed, public safety, waste disposal, operational flexibility, and global security.
Yatsko instead advocates for further investment in renewable energy solutions, writing that, quote, if advanced nuclear reactors cannot meet these metrics, they should not receive funding. Greg Yatsko joins us now to discuss. Welcome, Greg.
Hi, Ryan. It's good to be here with you.
Sure. So lay out for us the case for why you think these investments are a mistake right now.
Well, if we think about it, the major driving issue for electricity policy today is battling climate change. And right now we're basically at mile 13 of a marathon, and nuclear really wasn't even at the starting line when the race began. So, the solutions that are going to get us to what we need to do by, say, 2035 to have a net zero electricity sector are already the ones that are on the table. And everything we're seeing from nuclear right now is it's new ideas, it's new technology, it's things that haven't been proven yet and may not even be proven in the next decade. So that they're simply not practical solutions for the climate challenge and the climate issues that we face.
On Monday, the Illinois Senate saved two Exelon Corp nuclear power plants from closure by passing a bill that will provide $700 million in subsidies to the company over 5 years for generating virtually carbon-free power. And right, this is what we're seeing, time and time again. You were talking about this a little bit, Ryan, the enormous amount of subsidies that need to go into these projects to keep them running. Is that part of the problem, Greg?
Yeah, I mean, I think right now we're in a, as I said, we're in a race to combat this issue, and every dollar counts. And if we're spending it on technologies that don't have a future, that's money that's wasted. The solutions to this problem are pretty straightforward. We know we can deploy renewables at large scale to meet a lot of the challenges. What we have to do is get really the natural gas out of the system. And so, if this couple hundred million dollar subsidies for these nuclear reactors in Illinois doesn't do anything to get gas out of the system, then it's really not helping solve the problem. And we know the way to do that is to deploy new renewables, which are in many cases cost competitive or cheaper than natural gas. So rather than having to spend that money subsidizing a technology that's dying, we should put that money, if anything, into the technologies that are going to be there at the end of the race.
Greg, I'm curious what your thoughts are on the thorium nuclear reactors, because that is what China is actually firing up this month. They're going to start testing this new nuclear technology. So what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I was trained originally as a scientist, so I think this stuff is really cool. It's interesting technology, but from a practical standpoint, again, none of this is relevant to meeting the really urgent climate needs that we have. If you think about the goals to meet, say, the Paris Agreement goals or, meaningful climate reform, we need to get net zero electricity by 2035. And that means we're done in 2035. So the things that are going to get us there are going to be the things that are, deployed at the latest, say, in 2032. That's 10 years from now. And there's no nuclear technology, certainly in this country, that has ever gone from the drawing board to large-scale commercial production in 10 years. So, China's doing some interesting things from a technology standpoint, but these things are science more than they are practical energy solutions.
And so, Greg, you've spent much of your life, in and around the industry, former chair of the commission that oversees the nuclear industry. When in your life did you come to the conclusion that this was a dead end? Was there one particular thing, or was it a gradual accumulation of data?
Yeah, it was really an accumulation of data. It started when I was the chairman and I dealt with the Fukushima nuclear accident. So, know, that was an actual real accident for a technology that in many ways we had thought was past the point of ever having accidents. So that, you know, that certainly changed my thinking a lot about, you know, the safety and the reality of the safety concerns, that these weren't just issues that people were raising because they didn't like nuclear power, but these things really could happen. And then as you started to look really at what was happening outside the nuclear space, and, you know, this really tremendous revolution that's happened in the cost of renewables and the cost of batteries, the storage technology that we need right now to couple with the non-dispatchability of some renewable technologies. When you look at those two factors together, this challenge, continued challenge with nuclear power from a safety perspective, from a cost perspective, and the reality that the alternatives are actually there and they're cheaper and we can deploy them, it's really an obvious conclusion. You know, I think it's not really in many ways a debate or a discussion anymore. It's simply, you know, there's certainly a very powerful interest in Washington that continue to push for nuclear subsidies because, you know, there is, I think, sympathy within the Congress for the technology. But again, from a practical standpoint, it's just not something that you can use to deal with climate change.
Is it possible, though, that, you know, you say this is the state of the issue right now. Is it possible that that innovation has helped kind of tip us in the direction of the alternatives being better? Is it possible, though, that there could be some innovation that kind of rebalances it or tips it back towards nuclear?
You know, I think it's possible in 20 or 30 years, perhaps, but not, again, in the next 5 years. You know, if you look at the technologies that are on the drawing board right now, the closest an actual production of, say, an advanced reactor or so-called small modular reactor is expected to have effectively a demonstration reactor go online in 2030. Now, nuclear's never met the timelines they've established, but let's say that they meet that. Well, that gives you 2 years then to show that you can start deploying hundreds of those reactors or thousands of reactors like that, because they're small reactors, in 2 years. That's obviously not going to happen. So even if that innovation were to succeed, it would be at least 2 decades or, you know, 15 years before it could practically enter the commercial space. And by then, we've either figured out how to do net zero electricity or we haven't. And, you know, if we haven't, we're probably not really going to be too concerned by that point about, you know, these other technologies that could exist. So, you know, innovation is great. And, you know, but, the final point I'll say is that we often forget innovation in the other space. Innovation in renewables, in battery storage has actually been successful. So there's no reason to think that we can't have even greater innovation in that space to develop new storage technologies, to make solar more reliable, to make or more productive, more efficient, to make wind more efficient and cheaper. That's really where I think the innovation is going to continue to happen. So, you know, nuclear has had 60 years to innovate, and they really haven't done a good job at that. So I'm not sure why all of a sudden now nuclear will, you know, start to innovate, you know, dramatically in a way that could really solve our climate challenges.
Okay. How do your colleagues in the nuclear space feel about the public position that you've taken since leaving the commission? And is there a difference between what they say privately and what they say publicly?
You know, not a lot of people in the nuclear space like me, but that's probably the position they have. I don't get invited to a lot of nuclear cocktail parties.
Maybe that's better for your health.
But it, you know, I think it, to a certain extent, you know, privately there are, you know, people who acknowledge the challenges with the industry. I mean, I think, you know, privately, people in the nuclear sector recognize that nuclear is not a viable climate solution. Certainly not the large nuclear reactors that is the bulk of our nuclear fleet today. And you see that manifested publicly in the new ways that people talk about nuclear. You know, I think the issue du jour for nuclear is that nuclear is going to be the Bitcoin mining solution. Well, you know, talking about nuclear as kind of a Bitcoining solution is a little bit like saying that, you know, your car is best used as a place to listen to music. It might have a great sound system, but its primary use is to drive around. If it doesn't work for that, then that's probably not the right technology that you should be using.
Greg, thanks so much for joining us and educating us about this. We really appreciate it.
I'm glad to be with you.
We'll have more Rising right after this. Stick with us.